I know Regis will not talk about all of the things that he went through, but I want to say thank you very, very much for all that you've done, for all of the people you've talked to all around the world, for all of the you know, the things that you've done. And this is a very important film for all of us. And I hope that you all will support Regis and what he does, because he does it on a shoestring, But what you see here of people from all over the world that are telling us, we have got to get, I mean, everybody's working hard right now, but boy, we've got to work harder because we are facing a lot. And we want to thank you so much, Regis, for what you've done.
I cried all the time. I couldn't hold it together. It's very embarrassing. And you didn't need to do that. I think I've really been lucky. How many of you have heard of John Pilger?
Sure.
Well, for those of you who don't know him, he's a very famous Australian filmmaker. He's known all over the world. He's been filming since the Vietnam conflict. And he saw my film, The Ghost of Jeju. Well, his producer in London saw it, and because it had been screened a number of times there, and he called up Pilger in Australia, and he said, John, you've got to see this film. Well, I sell the film on the internet, and I didn't know who John Pilger was at the time. But an order came in from Australia. Jeez, what kind of DVD, the format that they use down there, and I sent it off. I don't know how much time went by, but I got a telephone call from John Pilger at dinner time. And he just kept talking about The Ghost of Jeju and how much it had influenced him. And he was going to make a new film, which is out now, and it's called The Coming War Against China. And he said, I just need to thank you so much for making that film. And I said, well, John, I'm really frustrated. I can't get anybody in the United States, distribution companies, movie theaters, to show the film. And I said, so I've had to schlep around the country, begging as I go, showing the film, and meeting with people afterwards and creating dialogue. And he said, Regis, I wish I had been doing that my entire life. Because when people go to a movie theater and see a film, the lights go on, everybody gets up and walks out. There's no discussion. There's no sharing of information. And so, long story short, with Pilger, when he created his final film, the third one, on Utopia, about the Aborigines in Australia, he offered the film for free in Australia. And then he held a massive screening in some convention center with like 3,000 people. And when the film was over and the lights were on, Pilger was on the stage with a microphone engaging the audience. So I stopped worrying about big time distribution. And one of the best things that's ever happened to me is to be able to go around the country and the world and meet people like you who are committed to peace and justice. So anyway, you know, I'm happy to answer some questions, but I know that all of you are steeped in the peace movement, anti-nuclear movement. I'd be really interested in your observations and your comments as well as maybe some folks asking questions.
How many languages is this Ghost of Jeju translated into now, Regis?
The Ghost of Jeju?
Yeah.
Did you hear the question? How many languages has been the Ghost of Jeju? Has it been translated in? 7.
Wow.
all by volunteers in different countries who said, our people need to see this. Yeah, and already somebody in Germany wants to translate this one, and the people in Russia, you can imagine the people in Russia would want to translate this one. I'm really interested in some of your observations and feedback, because I made this film to create some discussion, maybe some argumentation. Agneta.
Well, of course, I'm moved and very, I'm thinking a lot. But just a quick, I'm sitting here thinking of bringing it to Sweden. And I think it will, as Sweden has a tradition that women have been on the forefront in the government all over. So my observation here is that this is a very male film. Extraordinary male view. For me, too many male faces and comments. It could be possible for me to bring it to Sweden if the balance was more obvious. I was struck actually by the imbalance of male faces and women faces, just because I come from a country where women have been always on the forefront. Mm. That's my comment.
You did notice who ended the film, didn't you?
Pardon?
You noticed that it was a Native American woman who...
Yeah, I know. I always count 1, 2, 3, 4, and then I always count women and men in every aspect. Always. Always.
And I very
so
much
I noticed a lot of, but for me it was very male.
Yeah. I heard you say that before. I appreciate that. I think this would kick ass in Sweden if we brought it there.
I
think this would go over very big in Sweden. In Finland and Norway, and I am going to go to Norway and Finland. I've been invited there, and of course, back in Russia, they can't wait to see it. It's been viewed 21,000 times on YouTube by maybe more people in Europe and around the world than in the United States.
I'm sorry, you don't think do you think I'm overreacting, or don't you consider it yourself?
No, but you know how much I respect you. I don't want to focus on that tonight. I'm really concerned about the overall message and the impact that it's having on people.
Now you misunderstand me. Because if you count the world, and they have done it several times at the United Nations, those who are in the streets, those who are acting for peace are most of the time of extraordinary dominance of women. Mm. And this is what I say, and I don't think it is sort of what you said now. It is serious.
Yeah. I don't know if it's going to make you feel any better. I think that if humanity is going to find its way out of this, women are going to have to lead the way. I'll just leave it at that.
Yeah, that's what I mean.
Yeah, so well, I'd like to just not stay on this. I want to see what some other people think, but I respect what you're saying.
But we can get you three, four more people very quickly that you can insert in these from Okinawa and South Korea and other places. Just to add.
Yeah, the film is done. I mean, it's finished. But,
yeah.
And, I expect that there'll be, and I already received criticism from people. There have been more than a couple that really went after Putin and how I presented Putin through rose-colored glasses, people have said. I did that on purpose. I hope that it creates some discussion and some dialogue and a willingness of people to consider some other ideas and discussions and how other people feel about it.
Kind of on that topic, it's kind of obvious in the film that our picture of Putin and the Russian picture, Russian people picture of Putin is different, completely different. And I suppose some of that is from our media, the way things are done. And I recently saw something about some people in Syria were arguing that the Western news people are completely erroneously reporting what's going on in Syria. Do you suspect that there's some of that? I mean, what do you, from your experience traveling overseas and talking to people, do you see that sort of thing happening?
Most groups that I've shown it to, and this is the fifth group, ask similar questions, or they really attack me about Putin and what they think about him. And I did that deliberately. But the only answer that I can give is, if you don't want to compare the words of Putin and Obama and now Trump and Tillerson and whoever else is in there, compare their actions. Who has 800 bases around the world? Who has been killing, committing genocide, stealing resources and land for 500 years? It's not Russia, it's not China, it's not Putin. It's the United States, well, the early settlers that came here, and they weren't settlers, they were invaders. There were settlers here already. It's this country. Just compare the facts, the actions. How many countries has Putin invaded? He's the Russian Federation, he's not the Soviet Union. No.
It would have been fair to have at least some mention of Chechnya, because of course we know Putin is not a saint in Chechnya, even if his actions are better than Obama's.
I think maybe my next film might be about Chechnya. That's total lies and fabrication, American propaganda, okay? What happened in Chechnya was United States CIA instigated. The same stuff that's happening with Al-Qaeda, ISIS, Daesh, whoever you want to call it. Putin was called in by the people of Chechnya to come and save us, and he did it in 9 days. And the city, the town was destroyed, and Putin rebuilt it within a year. Within a year. They love him. The leader of Chechnya now is one of President Putin's biggest supporters. He is sending people wherever the Russian Federation need them, in Syria, Iraq, the Middle East, wherever. All I have to say is, and if this makes you mad, it's tough, I'm glad. The entire American narrative is a lie.
Yes, you are right.
If you don't
That's
like,
true.
If you don't like lie, it's myth. Yeah. And there's two things that have created that and extended it and keep it going. One is our educational system, and now it's all of media.
Yeah.
Media.
All of it. That's where most American people are getting their idea of who we are and what we're doing.
And that's one thing maybe you should have pointed at, media. But you can't have everything in the film. But media's extremely crucial role in creating, they are almost whipping up a war in Sweden towards Russia through media. I come from a peaceful country, and we are almost at war against Putin. And nobody can say what he has really done. But you know, media is absolutely war maker.
Yeah, and you know, I respect what this gentleman had to say. I really do. I'm a product of it. I just say, compare their actions. And I'm not saying Putin's a saint. I'm not saying he hasn't killed any of his opposition. But Putin hasn't killed on a scale that the United States of America has at all. At all. And I say, show me the facts. Show me the facts. They're not there. He hasn't done it. Yeah, he came up through the KGB. He's a very wily guy. He's very smart. He's not going to be provoked. Is he an oligarch? I don't know. Somebody told me that Putin is the richest man in the world.
Oh, no.
And I said, really? Well, somebody like Forbes must know that. And I asked the question when I was in Russia. Is Putin, you know, like a multi-billionaire? And they said, you know, we hear these kind of stories, but how would he ever have amassed that amount of money? The Russian people don't know. They can't figure it out. Anyway, yes.
Oh, Regis, thank you. I think it's a tremendously important film. I am astonished at the travel, the work, the effort, the number of speakers that you have. I think it's just extraordinary, exceptional, unique. There are a few people who have done this kind of work and put this narrative all together. So first of all, I thank you. I'm certainly going to take it back to New England and try to get it. I'd like to know two things. One, something about your own awakening. When did the scales fall away from your eyes? How were you able to suddenly become such a radical voice about the whole narrative, the whole 500 years, and issues such as...
You want to buy me a drink?
Well, certainly. That's a good
question. I'm going to compress this, because people, they always ask. I used to be a Roman Catholic priest. I wanted to save the world, make everything peaceful. Jesus, love, forgive. I had the opportunity in my journey to the priesthood to study in Rome for 4 years. I did all of my postgraduate work in Rome. In the Vatican, it's the right where it's at, right? Prior to that, I got an undergraduate degree in United States history. I just learned that version, memorized a bunch of dates and didn't analyze much. When I went to Rome, I was living in an international environment where students, classmates were from all over the world, everywhere. Because that's where they sent people they thought would become bishops and leaders in the church, and they sent them there for that. And for the first time in my life, I realized that America wasn't seen as that indispensable nation, that exceptional nation. And I went, oh boy, that hurts a little bit. And I was lucky to be able to travel in the summer and study languages and go to different countries throughout Europe. And I recognized that, Jesus, this is pretty cool over here. This is great culture. These are great people. They've got great history. And they sort of have a love-hate relationship with America. So that was the first time it sort of opened my eyes. Fast forward, it was a few years ago that Bruce Gagnon, who's my very good friend, was sitting in his office. And, we were there a lot of times just going back and forth. And he said, geez, I've got to find three people to send to Jeju, because I got money and they want people to go over there. And I said, well, I'll go. And he said, are you serious? Well, yeah, I'll go make a film. And Gagnon says to me, will your wife let you? And 3 weeks later, I was on a plane going to South Korea and Jeju Island and made that film, The Ghost of Jeju, which I didn't think I was going to make that film. I thought I was just going to film this little protest that was going on. That opened my eyes. I cried when I found out what our country did. Before the war, they orchestrated a massacre of as many as 30 to 60,000 innocent people on this island who were protesting the occupation of the United States government in Korea. They thought they were just liberated from 38 years of Japanese occupation, which was brutal. They rose up, and under the hands and guidance of the United States military government, these people were scorched. George Stewart policy. 18 months, they were massive. And I found that out when I went there, and I cried. I still do. I was so angry. And there was the history of it there. They had these pictures, frames, with the history of what happened. Pictures of these American generals and Sigmund Rhee. I'm taking pictures of all this because I was, geez, I'll never remember this. I'll never find this in a book. And when I came home, I was very troubled. Very, very troubled. And I started to do research. And I went to the National Archives in College Park, Maryland, and researched. I sought out people like Bruce Cummings, who are one of the leading academics on the history of Korea and that part of the world. Other people who were considered experts, and I found them out, interviewed them, and made that film. And I knew at the end of that film that this was going to come from, I didn't know what this was, I just knew it was going to be a much more intense study of American militarism and war and American presence around the world and what it was doing to people, culture, and the environment. And it made me very angry. I still am. I make no apologies for being angry. Thomas Aquinas said that if you're not angry in the face of immorality, you're also immoral for giving credence and acceptance to evil. So that's how it happened. And I joined Veterans. I'm not a veteran. For any of you veterans here that I haven't met, I joined Veterans for Peace because my second child, the oldest son, joined the United States Army a number of years ago and became a Green Beret. And I was very upset and very worried about him. And Bruce said, geez, you know, you've got to join Veterans for Peace. It'd be a great support group. And that's how I got here. I wear this everywhere. I don't have too many other clothes that I wear. This is Veterans for Peace. I have t-shirts. I have hoodies. I have a jacket. And I wear it everywhere, all the time. So yeah, that's how I got really radicalized. And when Occupy happened, I had just been fired by the governor of Maine, who's a Tea Party guy. I had a appointed position, and I thought, what am I going to do? And Occupy started. And in the 60s, I was in the seminary in Europe. And so I wasn't out in the streets and that kind of thing. And I go, well, I'm not going to miss this one. So I started documenting Occupy in Maine, created a TV show that lasted for 10 months. We did a show a month. And that was really now biting into the whole piece of pie. So that's the answer to that question. Yes?
Regis, I want to just congratulate you on the movie.
I
want to congratulate you on the movie. I think it's really good. I think it's extremely important for us to challenge the American narrative. If you do that, you're not going to get your film shown everywhere because we have a very controlled media in this country. I call it propaganda, actually. And so we've got to, you know, show audiences where we can. And, you know, I heard the voices of that there need to be more women's voices and things, and I hear that with my own work a lot, and just make sure that I always, in the next project, understand that and listen to it. But I think it's very important. I've been to some of the places, a number of the places that you show in the film, and for instance, the thing on Russia, I asked the same questions you did, and I got the same answers. I don't think you were coloring it that way on purpose. I think that was the reality of what was in Russia in terms of people's liking of Putin. I don't think Putin has the answers that are going to change the world for the better in the long run. But it is true. I sat through the press conference that he gave while I was there. He sat at that press conference for hours.
4 hours.
Yeah, and he answered every question. And they allowed into that press conference all sorts of people. A right-wing reporter from Kiev, pro-Nazi guy. And he just let him speak and speak and speak and then answer point by point by point. The BBC reporter answered point by point by point.
And
you would never see that in the United States If someone ever asked that at one of our presidential news conferences, they'd be kicked out, and they would never be allowed back again.
No teleprompter, no teleprompter, no notes, and no expert sitting next to him whispering in his ear. Right? So what Joe is saying, I've watched hundreds of hours of Putin's speeches going back a number of years. You know, he may have things that he's done that are bad and wrong, but if you look at what he's said for the last, since 2000, when he's president, what he's tried to do, it's not been aggressive. It's not been belligerent towards the outside world. It's been trying to, imagine this. What if, and it could happen, the American economy completely collapsed tomorrow? Completely. We wouldn't be able to fund those 800 bases, those tens of thousands of American men and women who were in the military. What would they do? Would they be abandoned in these other countries? What would happen in this country? We're fighting for food. We're fighting, who knows what would happen? It'd be just chaos. That's kind of what happened in the Soviet Union when it crashed. It crashed. And what's happened in the Soviet Union is nothing short of a miracle. It was like a phoenix rising from the ashes. Putin did it. It was his vision to rebuild Russia based on their history, their culture, and their religion. He supposedly is a devout Orthodox, Russian Orthodox Christian. I saw several incredible churches, Orthodox churches, that Putin rebuilt. They had been bombed during the war, the Nazis and stuff. Putin had them rebuilt. He's an amazing man. And right now, and I just want people to think about it. He is the only one on the world stage that wants things de-escalated. He doesn't want war. He keeps talking about peace. And the Russian
people. They are disarming. They are disarming.
Yeah, I got it. You know that. He's cut his budget again this year. They've cut the military. They're below a million men, women, in their military. Below a million now. At the end of the Soviet Union, they were 4 million. Yeah, he's cut his budget back. But what they did tell me, the colonel, he was part of the elite, like our West Point. He was a professor there. And he was a professor of computer engineering, computer science. What he said was Putin decided he wasn't going to get into an arms race with the United States again. He realized what that did to his country. What he's done, he's invested in very, very high-tech technology. I don't know if some of you have read some of the reports, but the U.S. missile defense system, it's a joke anyway, but the Russians have develop technology, they can totally disarm it.
Yeah.
They can disarm a ship, they can disarm a plane. They've already done it. They've already shown what they can do. And what they insisted on is not quantity, but the quality of what they invested in their military technology. Putin has done that. Yeah. Anyway, yes?
I would say I watched part of that press conference that Putin gave also. It was very, very impressive. Regis, I like your film, and I really appreciate it. I'm glad you did. In your tour of bases, however, you didn't go to Yokosuka Naval Base.
I didn't go
to Yokosuka Naval Base.
Oh.
And I got to tell you, I'm 81 years old, okay? And the biggest turning point in my life, my feeling about my country, realized I'm growing up, coming to consciousness. During World War II, you know, very patriotic, you know. I'm joining the Navy and I'm proud of that, et cetera. But in the summer of 1956, I'm in Yokosuka, Japan, talking to my Japanese girlfriend, and I find out she doesn't remember any bombing during the war. She was born and grew up next to the main base of the Imperial Japanese Navy. And it hadn't occurred to me, hey, wait a minute, you know, But the next morning, I went up on the signal bridge of the ship, and I'm looking around, and yeah, there's some new construction, but there were all these old buildings. So I started gradually, hard for me to take, you know, but gradually, looking into the history, okay, one of the dual bombers brought one 500-pounder on its way to Tokyo, but after that, we never, as far as I've been able to search the history, never bombed the main base of the Imperial Japanese Navy. In late July of 1945, Nimitz ordered a dive bomber attack on the Nagato, a battleship, but not against the base itself, you know. And look further into the history, and this is something that I think can turn people when they realize it, because so many people believe the bomb ended the war and saved so many millions, you know? No, why not? If you had to drop a bomb, the military target, they would have been able to see the mushroom cloud from Tokyo, you know?
You know what I learned about how do you pronounce it?
Yokosuka.
Yokosuka. Bruce Cummings mentioned it in The Ghost of Jeju. What I heard from another supposedly Korean scholar is the United States didn't bomb that base because they wanted it.
That's right.
You know, as soon as
Jimmy Burns, the Secretary of State to Harry Truman, who's the closest advisor, he's quoted as saying, demonstrating that bomb will be a big help in working against the Russians in Europe. That's what it was about.
Yeah.
That we didn't bomb this really important military base ever in the war. Early in the war, up high, a decision was made. That's going to be our base.